Ham Radio Now, episode 27, is on the air. The Rocket Man and the Balloon Man. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Welcome the worldwide audience to Ham Radio Now. We are closing in on the last of the interviews that we shot down at the Huntsville Ham Fest way back last August. Very productive Ham Fest, lots of good interviews, but we're almost done with them. We got these two today, and then two more, and then we move on to lots of other stuff that we've got waiting in the queue to put online here on Ham Radio Now. Let's see. Yes, in this this show, we're going to do an interview with Bill Brown, WB8ELK. Bill's the Balloon Man, and you might be familiar with Bill. Bill's been doing high-altitude ham radio ballooning for a long time. In fact, right around the Huntsville Ham Fest last August was his 25th anniversary of sending up ham radio on high-altitude near-space balloons. So he'll talk about that. And we're also going to talk to a ham named David Stephenson, KJ4OKJ. David's probably not so familiar to people unless you live in the Huntsville area. It's only been a ham for a short time, but he's our rocket man. He's a retired NASA rocket scientist. So we'll talk to him. In fact, Jeff is going to do that interview in a couple of minutes. I do want to acknowledge that we have a worldwide audience for Ham Radio Now. I get a lot of email from hams all over the world, particularly Australia. It seemed to be pretty popular down there, but hams all over the place. And some of them have said, don't forget, we're out here, the rest of the world. So keep that in mind as you make programs for Ham Radio Now. And with that in mind, I would like to invite you, if you're outside of the U.S., outside North America, to send me email, kn4aq@arvn.tv. If you've got an idea for a program, for a guest, someone that we can talk to on Skype, and find out a little bit more about what ham radio is like in other parts of the world, people who are doing interesting things and have a story to tell, I'd like to do some episodes like that. Not quite ready for serious Skype interviews yet. I'm still figuring out this Wirecast thing and the Skype integration to it. I've made some progress, but I've got a little ways yet to go to make all that work. So not quite ready, but be thinking about what might be interesting to a worldwide audience and a U.S. audience from other parts of the world, and toss me some email about that, especially if you'd make a good guest. Let's see what else is next. This weekend, Jeff and I are going down to Charlotte to the Lowe's Motor Speedway to watch a NASCAR race. This is one of the 500-mile ones, fairly big one. Now, I'm not a big NASCAR fan. I'm not a big sports fan in general. I enjoy outdoor activities. I enjoy stuff that I participate in. But as a fan, or somebody watching, not so much. Jeff's a big fan. He's the big NASCAR fan. I'm going down to play with him. And the thing that will be the most interesting to me about the race is all the radio communication that's going to be going on down there. And I've got this scanner. This is a Radio Shack Pro 106, pretty high-end digital scanner. Nothing's digital down there, but all of the cars, all of the officials, all of the track, security, all that stuff, in the 450, 460 megahertz band, and I've got just about all that programmed in the scanner. So I will be enjoying the shortwave listening aspect of the NASCAR race. And the scanner stuff and the race activity becomes most interesting when there's a big crash. Everybody gets all excited about that. And even among the NASCAR fans, the rabid diehard NASCAR fans, scanning is a big deal. They sell scanners, they sell programs, things like that. So everybody knows to tune in to the lead car, the car that's in the accident, the officials, the safety teams, all that stuff. It should be very interesting for me, even if watching the cars go round and round real fast and turn left, not my most important thing. So, well, we'll see. I've been down to a few with Jeff, and it's always been fun. Next, QRZ.com. Once again, I want to thank the folks at QRZ.com for putting up the notices of the Ham Radio Now episodes as they come up. I don't have a place for a blog or a place for comments on Ham Radio Now yet. Someday the website is going to have something like that. Someday when I get one of those round to its. For now, probably the best place if you want to make comments on the episodes is in the comment section that follows the announcement of the episode on QRZ.com. Good blogging section there, a good place for you to make comments. The only problem is that it is somewhat infected by a group of hams whose primary pleasure in life seems to be just trying to cause trouble, making comments that are designed to inflame, to get comments back, and generally stir the pot. The same kind of hams and the same kind of people in general. They're all over the internet. They've infected the internet. They infect ham radio. Before the web was real popular, they pretty much ruined a thing called Usenet, where there were ham radio discussion groups, and they would get on there and just basically trash the place. Now, I'm a big fan of freedom of speech. I'm a big fan of the First Amendment. I like the idea that everybody gets to have their say. And I don't want to shut them down. I don't want to tell them they can't make comments. They're welcome to make comments. I can take whatever they want to say about me, whether they've got any facts to back up what they're going to say or not. The antidote for that kind of speech is not turning it off. It's more speech. So I encourage, if you're a fan of the show, if you've got a comment to make about any of the episodes that you see, to go to QRZ.com. And go visit the sections where you can make replies and put them there so that these guys aren't the predominant comments, the predominant material that you find on the announcement of the episode. We can have some good discussions about some of the subjects that we talk about here on Ham Radio Now. If a lot of you who have something cogent, something serious, something real to say about it, get on there and make those comments, and we'll kind of crowd those guys out. So once again, the antidote to their kind of speech is more speech. Next, I would like to do a program on this new FCC notice of proposed rulemaking that came out last week. I'm not quite ready to do that. I want to do that with a Skype interview with some folks, probably at ARRL or maybe a few others. We can find out more about what the background is and what's really to this notice of proposed rulemaking. It's got some interesting things in it. It's kind of, you know, shook the salt shaker into it, and it's got a lot of different things in it. So we'll try an episode like that. Maybe next week. Very busy freelance week for me next week. The episode, the material will stay somewhat fresh for a while. They haven't even published it yet, so that the comment section for you at the FCC has not been opened. So we'll work on that. And once again, I'm still working out this Wirecast and the Skype thing, so I'm not quite ready to do that. I had a note here to put the bear on. And unfortunately, the bear who was sitting on my lap while I was getting things set up here decided to wander away. So the bear is not here. But I've gotten some email from folks that say they like to see the bear. So the next time the bear comes wandering around, and he might come back before I finish off the introduction and close for this episode, and we'll see. We'll put the bear back on. I'm glad to see that the bear is very popular with you out there. Okay, I think that's it. It's time to head back down to Huntsville and talk to the Balloon Man, Bill Brown, WB8ELK, on the 25th anniversary of his first balloon flight. Bill? Hey, Bill Brown, WB8ELK. It's good to see you again. Last time I ran into you, I think, was at a Tapper conference. And
yes.
And a little brush-by encounters at Dayton here and there.
All right.
This is an anniversary of sorts?
Yes, this is the 25th anniversary of my first high-altitude amateur radio balloon flight, and launched that on August 15th, 1987, in Ohio, and it actually carried a 2-meter transmitter and a TV camera and transmitter.
1987. That transmitter must have been made of tubes and...
Well, actually, the transmitter was
200
all discrete.
Volt power supply.
There was no integrated circuits on it. It was all transistors. And I had a tube camera. The TV camera had a little mini tube in it.
So there was a tube.
There was a tube. And it was the world's smallest TV camera at the time. So We are at the cutting edge of miniaturization.
Why did you think to do that 25 years ago? And did you have any idea what you were doing and how it had to be done?
Well, I was the first to do it in the U.S., so I had to figure out how to do it. So what inspired me to do it was I saw a thing about Joe Kittinger parachuting from the edge of space from 103,000 feet. And he was jumped out of a high-altitude balloon wearing a partial pressure early spacesuit. And it was at the early days of the space age where they were testing things like pressure suits and how the environment of the stratosphere would affect astronauts.
I think we saw the capsule that he stepped out of. Is that the one that's on display at the Wright-Patterson?
Yes, it's at the Air and Space Museum.
Yeah,
at the
Wright-Patterson. I remember that. Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then just recently, there is a fellow who is jumping out of balloon to try and beat Joe Kittinger's parachuting record. They're flying out of New Mexico. And he just recently jumped from 98,000 feet, and Joe Kittinger is their advisor. But Joe wrote about his experiences from the stratosphere. From that altitude, you can see the blackness of space, even though it's daylight. You're above 99% of the Earth's atmosphere. You can actually see the curvature of the Earth. And you can see 400 miles in all directions. Now, I always enjoyed mountain topping, driving up to a mountain, to see how far I can get on 2 meters and 440 band to do mountain topping DX. And I love to do mountain topping. And in fact, I live on a mountain here just south of Huntsville. And I bought it just for that reason, so I have a great RF location. So antenna height, as you know, is everything. And so from 100,000 feet, if you had an antenna that tall, you could talk 400 miles day and night
line
in all directions, line of sight. So I said, man, if I could put a TV transmitter and a 2 meter transmitter on a balloon and send it up 100,000 feet, it would cover 8 states, the entire Midwest or most of the Southeast here. So I thought, I'll have to do that. So I did some research where I went, they launch twice a day radio sondes to test the winds aloft for the pilot forecasts. And I went to visit one of those sites and saw what they do. They have a little 1,680 megahertz transmitter, and sometimes they fly about 403 megahertz. And a little tiny transmitter, they send it up on a weather balloon with a parachute, and they collect the data and tells them where the winds are, wind fields are, that they give to pilots. And they still do that in 72 sites across the United States twice a day. There's one in Nashville, and there's one in Birmingham, Alabama, near here.
So this is sort of the hitchhiker's guide to the stratosphere.
And that's exactly right. So I thought, if I could put a ham radio on a similar system, just think how fun that would be. So I got everything together, did a lot of research, and finally decided to do it myself. And I chose August 15th, 1987, as my first flight date. And why did I do that on that particular date? It's my birthday. So it was a gigantic
happy birthday to me.
That's right.
The highest birthday present anyone on Earth has ever received.
That's right.
That's near about the birthday of ham radio. I mean, a few years off, but date-wise, isn't it?
August 17th. Yeah.
August 17th.
Well, sort of Congress passed the thing on the 13th, signed on the 17th, effective sometime in December.
Okay. Yeah.
So,
but the year is a little bit later than the beginning of ham radio.
Yeah. So how far did that balloon go?
Well, that balloon went up about 90,000 feet. It barely got off the ground because I had miscalculated how much helium it was going to take my payload off the ground. And it was a 20-knot wind. So we brought it out. It went crashing. My carefully designed payload went crashing into the ground 4 times before it finally barely took off. And now that was before GPS and before APRS. We had to use direction finding fox hunting techniques to locate it. So we all had directional beams and just chased it through visual and by DF techniques. And
you found it.
We lost it.
Oh, forever?
The transmitter died on the way down. We had it. We knew exactly where the burst point is. We knew approximately where it had landed, because I had to write a program that took that those winds aloft I talked about that the radiosondes tell us. I used those winds aloft forecasts and wrote a program to tell me where the balloon's going to land. So I can tell you when I launch from here in Huntsville on any particular day and any particular time, I can tell you probably within a 5-mile circle where it's going to land.
Up 100,000 feet.
Yes.
And back down.
And this is a free flight balloon where I actually take my cargo of payload that is fairly expensive. Sometimes I fly $1,000 worth of ham radio equipment.
Oh.
And I want it back. So I really want to know where it's going to go. And if it's going to land in a total wilderness area, I need to know that kind of thing. So I will choose my flight dates or my launch location depending on where I want it to land. So we gave up. We searched and searched, but we couldn't hear any signals from it. 6 weeks later, a farmer called me because I have something on the payload called a backup recovery system. It's a reward sign.
We'll pay you to send this back.
That's right. And I've used that backup recovery system many, many times over the years. But he called me. He says, I found something while I was harvesting my soybeans. And it's right in the middle of the bean field. And thought maybe it was a bomb, but then I saw a reward and your phone number. So I figured maybe it's not a bomb, but I'll call you first. So we drove about 20 miles north of Findlay, Ohio, and got my payload back.
So that is now in the WB8ELK Museum.
It is, actually.
How far was this farmer's field from the area that you had searched before and calculated it would be?
We drove right by the field.
Okay, so right in the area.
Yeah, we were right in the area. We were just a mile or two away from...
Unless you can afford a helicopter for that.
We had a chase plane, but he couldn't see it because it had fallen down below the soybeans. So.
Oh, yeah.
But chase planes have worked in the past. We've done many flights where we've actually had a chase plane watch the parachute coming down and land.
That's
so in
good.
The 25 years since, how many balloons have you sent up?
About 400. And they've ranged in size from a little 10 milliwatt 434 megahertz. Basically, they're like garage door opener keychains. And believe it or not, you can hear that 10 milliwatt signal from over 150 miles away. And we actually had one that had a GPS attached to it. It's a little $4 transmitter on 434 megahertz, and it sends down teletype and Domino EX. I've been sending a lot of payloads with a digital mode called Domino EX. It's a multi-frequency shift keyed mode.
What's the advantage of that over PSK or whatever?
The advantage of it is, well, similar to PSK-31, it is a very weak signal mode. Because when I'm dealing with a low power transmitter like that, the signals are very weak. So you can copy that. I use a program called FL Digi. We have a specially modified version of FL Digi that when you decode this telemetry string from my transmitters, it forwards it to a website in Great Britain and displays it on a map, just like the APRS maps would do on either APRS FI or FindU. And I also do carry APRS on most of my payloads now.
Now you do?
Yes.
Now that it's been invented?
Now that it was invented.
Thank
we
you, Bob.
We flew the first digipeater on a balloon when Packet was just starting out. And we had people talking.
Well, they're blaring at us. You got to get right up on that mic.
Okay. We were talking through the digipeater from 8 different states. I talked to hundreds of people from 400 miles away using the balloon as a digipeater mode. And everybody was kind of upset when it landed because they were having such a ball.
That would be a fun thing to do and a good way to get lots of hams involved.
Yes. Now, well, we've done some interesting long-duration flights lately. And the really neat thing is we've sent up crossband repeaters. You come in
voice repeaters.
Voice repeaters. And a simplex repeater. Do you know how a simplex repeater would work?
Store and forward.
The store and forward. So you talk, it records your voice, and it plays it back on the same frequency. I've had a lot of fun with that because it's fairly easy to do. You just take an HT and a store and forward unit. Argent Data makes one that's a simplex repeater unit. You just hook it up, launch it, And you get people talking from hundreds of miles apart through the balloon. I did that for field day a couple of years ago. I fly
a
balloon.
What kind of frequency do you use?
Usually on 2 meters, FM. This is a simplex channel.
Not 5.2, I'll guess.
Generally not 5.2, no.
How do you get people to know that it's out there?
We actually have a website for amateur radio high-altitude balloons. It's called rhab.org. A-R-H-A-B, for amateur radio high-altitude balloons.org. And that is a great resource to go to find out about upcoming balloon flights that are popping up with ham radio. And look, there's a records page for highest altitude, longest radio content.
It's cool to have the site. I'm guessing that is not a go-to destination for enough hams to really fill up a frequency like that for you. So get the word out some other ways, too?
Yes, we have a number of Yahoo groups.
Okay, those are going to be more popular.
And we have quite a following. There's one called GPSL, which actually stands for Great Plains Super Launch. And it's a conference where all the ham radio balloon groups come, and we launch 10 balloons at once usually and have a conference, and we describe our various things that we're building for telemetry and ham experiments and balloon techniques.
You got this started. It's been picked up by lots of other people. You're doing a lot of mentoring now, teaching people how to do this?
Yes, I do. We go into school systems. This is a great way to teach students about amateur radio, science, and space, because you literally are sending experiments into the edge of space, into the stratosphere. It's a near vacuum, a very space-like environment, and it's very cold. It's like 45 below zero. One of the experiments we recently did was we sent up, as part of Spaceport Indiana, we have a space and science camp for middle school and high school students. And we teach them about amateur radio and space and science. And we sent up a bunch of crickets. We called them cricket knots instead of astronauts.
Oh.
Now, would you think a cricket would survive?
At that temperature, I wouldn't think much would survive.
Now I didn't
cockroach,
think... cockroach, yeah. But we didn't think that a cricket would survive, but one of the students wanted to fly crickets. And I said, okay, you know, crickets, we won't feel too bad if they don't survive, but because they were fishing.
Oh,
crickets.
You're going to get email.
Well, believe it or not, when they landed, they had been up in over 80,000 feet up in the stratosphere in a vacuum, 45 below zero. We opened up the payload. The crickets all jumped out and ran around the yard. Not one died.
They were all alive.
They all survived.
Yeah, but they were subjected to radiation and mutated and are now taking over the Earth.
Well,
yeah.
They're taking over my friend's yard in Indiana because they were not happy.
Was there some knowledge that they could survive harsh conditions, or was it just on a whim?
It was based on a rumor that crickets could hold their breath for 2 hours. There was an internet rumor, and that's how they based why the student decided to fly those. We've had all kinds of interesting experiments.
That's little protection against the temperature, though.
We've had all kinds of interesting experiments that students like to fly. Radiation badges. We've had moon pie. Believe it or not, we flew a moon pie. Of course, that's a southern delicacy here.
It returned tasty.
We had a control moon pie, and then we had a near space moon pie. We call it near space is where we go because we're near to the edge of space. It was, all the air had been sucked out of it. It was half the size. And then we did a taste test with the students. And they sampled an old moon pie, the original moon pie, and then the one that had gone up in the balloon.
Near space.
And they all loved the near space moon pie because it had better consistency. It tasted better. So
I want to perform that experiment. I want to perform it now.
What I'm wondering is, I guess the ascent is slower than the descent, yeah?
Well, it's a regular, times. The ascent rate is approximately 1,000 feet per minute. A typical amateur radio high-altitude balloon mission takes about an hour and a half to 2 hours to get to 100,000 feet. And then the balloon pops because it's in a near vacuum. It's getting bigger and bigger. Parachute comes out, takes about 30 minutes to come back. At first, it's falling you know, 100 miles an hour or more.
No
And
air.
Then it catches more air and then it levels out. And it lands fairly gently, hopefully. Now, we did a flight to just yesterday from near the Huntsville Ham Fest.
I wanted to ask what you did to commemorate this 25-year anniversary of your first...
within a couple of days of the actual 25th anniversary of my first flight and the first flight in America of amateur radio high altitude balloons.
Okay, that's one small step for man, one giant leap for our 25th anniversary balloon.
I launched a 2-meter FM transmitter, an HF transmitter on 20 meters, running 700 milliwatts, just 3/4 of a watt.
On its way to California.
It was on 14.103 megahertz, and we were running Domino EX, teletype, and good old-fashioned Morse code.
And what's Domino EX?
Domino EX is an 18-tone multi-frequency shift keyed. It's like an one of the MFSK kind of modes.
Sounds like R2-D2.
It was developed in New Zealand, and it should be popular because it's a beautiful weak signal mode. You can copy signals right down in the noise with it. So when you have a weak HF signal, you want something where you can dig the signal out. And so we flew that transmitter with a GPS receiver, and also we had... APRS transmitter on board.
Now, something you were explaining to me before that I didn't know was the winds, higher than winds aloft, winds on the edge of space, in this time of year, go contrary to the typical prevailing winds. You know, usually it's west to east in this hemisphere.
Right. In the summertime, July and August, the winds above 60,000 feet are coming from the east, so your balloon's going to drift to the west. So my goal was to send it all the way to California. Now, there's a special technique that you can do to get a balloon to float where you just barely put enough helium to lift everything off the ground. And we have these new balloons that are coming in from China, and they seem to work pretty well at floating. And I just got it to float at 109,000 feet after it took 4 hours, and it went clear to Georgia. It went east 80 miles. To Georgia, hit 60,000 feet, and then started coming back when it hit those easterly winds. And it actually, at 5 o'clock, I launched at 1, at 5 o'clock, I walked outside from the Huntsville Ham Fest, and the balloon went right overhead.
Did you see it?
We couldn't see it because it was too hazy, but we were direction finding my 2-meter beacon, and it was directly overhead.
And heading west.
And heading west at about 40 miles an hour.
After these 400 launches, when you do something like that, when you're receiving those signals, do you still feel the thrill?
It's a big thrill. It is a huge thrill every mission.
Still the kid in you just jumps up and down?
And in fact,
the adult in you still jumps up and down.
The chase is really one of the favorite parts. Trying to track it down, and it can land anywhere. We know approximately where it's going to land, although this particular one went all the way to Wichita Falls, Texas. It went 23 hours, and it's almost 900 miles downrange. And it landed in Texas, and it's hanging in a tree near a road, and we've got a crew out there, a group in Texas that launches high-altitude balloons. They're on their way out to recover it.
Did you get a bunch of signal reports?
We have signal reports. Poland, there was a station in Poland, picked it up and copied the telemetry. Arizona, California, Wisconsin, Colorado, and here in Huntsville, all kinds of people are picking up the signal on 20 meters. In fact, it's hanging in a small tree after it landed, and we're still picking up the telemetry. It told us exactly where it landed. And it's still transmitting right now.
Now, your hope was to fly it to California.
Yes, but the ultraviolet radiation degrades the latex in a weather balloon. And so I figured it would get to it eventually.
Usually when they go up with no altitude control, they burst.
Usually.
This was altitude controlled, so it didn't burst. So it just degraded.
It was just a technique where I didn't put much helium in it. And a very low ascent rate, and it sometimes will float.
Yeah, cool.
It doesn't always.
We're running very low on tape here, so we'll have to wrap up pretty quick. Anybody who wants to find out more about what you're doing, where do they go look for you?
You can go to my website, which is WB8ELK.com, or arhab.org. That's another great website that displays all the amateur radio high altitude balloon groups that are out there.
All right. And you'd, I'm sure, be glad to hear from people who want to try this for the first time.
Absolutely.
People who have things to tell you about what they've accomplished.
Do I have time to ask about the legal requirements?
I don't know. Ask, and if we can squeeze it in.
Bill, what legal requirements have to be met to launch a balloon like that?
The FAA rules, it's Part 101, it allows a six-pound payload up to 2 6-pound payloads. You can't exceed a six-pound payload, and as long as you meet those requirements, so a total of 12 pounds, as long as you meet those requirements, you can fly.
No approval required.
That's right. If you want to go higher than that, then you're going to have to get go through a waiver or announcement.
If we were to call you the balloon man, you'd be mistaken for someone going to children's parties, I guess. So.
Right, you can just call me a balloonatic.
That sounds good. Thank you, Bill.
That is good.
Absolutely. It's been a pleasure.
All right.
Thank you, Bill. And again, congratulations on 25 years of a fascinating little niche in ham radio. Now, I've got a bunch of other stuff that I have recorded with Bill. And let's go over to the website. Oops, not that website. We need to go to the ARVN website. This is kind of old stuff. It's from a Tapper ARRL Digital Communications Conference. Back in 2009, and here it is, and let's see, these are all still on DVD, they have not been put on the web yet, and here in DVD number 2, stuff on space, well, DVD 2 has got Steve Bible and 7HPR talking about Arisat. This is before Arisat went up, so an interesting talk there. And then two programs from Bill Brown. One is on a transmitter that he designed for these long-distance balloons, an HF transmitter that runs QRP on a variety of digital modes so that he can, I think he runs 20 meters, 30 meters, so that he can get information back from those long-distance balloons. And then Bill was also the banquet speaker on Saturday night, and he talks about the balloons and the rockets that he's sent up. And most of it is ham radio related, but not all of it. So interesting talk. Again, that's still all on DVD. So if you want it, it's going to cost you $15, but it's worthwhile. And once again, head to the ARVN website. That's arvn.tv. And you can find those. Some of the Tapper stuff that I've done is now on the web. The 2011 Tapper material is all on the web. Let's go find that. Can I figure out where it is? It's Ham Radio Now. Oh, no, it's not part of Ham Radio Now. It's still part of ARVN.tv. In fact, I've lost control of my computer. There we go. It's still down here at the Tapper thing. Just click on the DCC. And here at 2011, we've got all of the sessions, all of them available for watching on the web. And the 2012 stuff that I just shot will also end up on the web if you want to watch that. When we get it done. It should be coming out over the next couple of weeks. Next, the Rocket Man, David Stephenson, KJ4OKJ. This is an interview that Jeff conducted, but I ran into David in the aisle on Sunday morning at the Huntsville Hamfest. And I'm not sure how we ended up talking, but we were just having a conversation. And since he was a ham, interested in technology, lived in Huntsville, I mentioned offhand and just kind of kidding, well, do you happen to be a rocket scientist? And he said, well, yes. Yes, he was. He's retired from NASA. He is a rocket scientist. So we had a great conversation, and Jeff joined about halfway through, and I realized that I wished this conversation were being recorded, because I think you would enjoy it too. So I asked him to come by the booth, and then I asked Jeff to conduct the interview. So this is a conversation between Jeff, AC4ZO, and a rocket scientist from NASA down at the Huntsville Hamfest.
Okay, here with us today, we have somebody I think you're going to be interested in. Welcome. Thanks for joining us today. Who are you?
Well, glad to be here. I'm David Stephenson. I am a recent NASA retiree. I spent about 40 years in the space and rocket business.
Now, and there's something very surprising about your background that most of our viewers are gonna find surprising. How long? You were at NASA for 40 years.
Yes.
And you became a ham?
About a little over two years ago.
2 years ago. So it wasn't ham radio that gave you your interest in science, especially rocket science, and it wasn't. And science had little to do with you becoming a ham, didn't it?
Very little. I was since I was about 3 or 4 years old, my mother took me up in an airplane when I was about 4 years old, and that did it. From then on, I loved anything that flew.
Ah.
So I became a pilot and also worked on airplanes some, but mostly rockets.
And all that time, go ahead and move right up on that microphone there. All that time, you've been around radios, but your interest was more in aeronautics, wasn't it?
Well, yes. I did flight op. In NASA speak, flight operations is where you practice for your launches. And you have all the different voice loops, and you're talking to people in various locations. Mm-hmm. So you get used to talking on the radio and tuning out those loops that you may be listening to, but you have your primary loops that you have to cover, mm-hmm. and the others that you listen for information only.
I see. Now, 40 years ago, things were different than they are now. Maybe not so much in ham radio, but what was NASA doing 40 years ago?
Well, we were doing this little thing called going to the moon.
Well, the first manned flight was 69, right? August 69, is that
actually
right?
Actually, it depends on how far back you want to go. The first Americans went up in the 61, 62 time frame, and then we had the The Mercury program,
right,
was a single person in each capsule, and then the Gemini program was two people, and they also did docking and rendezvous to practice what they needed would be required for the moon mission. And then following the Gemini series was the Apollo series, and of course the Saturn V, the mm-hmm. big moon rocket, was designed, and some of the early models were actually fabricated right here in Huntsville.
Uh-huh. At what Space Center?
Actually, the Space Center is merely the museum. The Marshall Space Flight Center used to have a very large manufacturing facility area, and that's where this items got built.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you came to NASA, it was in the Saturn V era. It was just after the Gemini program, is that right? Or were you?
I came up here. I was working up here in the summers when I was still going to college. So my first summer up here was 1964.
Okay, so you're a few years older than you look.
Well, they say it's not the years, it's the miles.
Okay. Okay, all right. Okay, so in 64, we were still in the Mercury Redstone, or were we in Gemini by then?
We would have been in the Gemini series by then.
By then, okay. So you've got a long history. Now, all those years, you probably worked side by side with many ham radio operators.
That's quite possible, but I'm not cognizant of that.
Okay, and they didn't fly the ham radio banner or flag then, did they? But a couple years ago, something changed, and we got you. We got you in ham radio now.
That's right. About 2 or 3 years ago, I came to a ham fest right here in Huntsville, and I was interested because I had heard that they had dropped the requirement for CW or Morse code.
Uh-huh.
And I had been a Boy Scout in my early youth,
right?
And had been exposed to Morse code then. Mm-hmm. But then I had not practiced any of that for, you know, many, many, many years. And I knew that I would probably never become proficient at it. So I was very pleased to find out that you could come in and do voice only.
Mm-hmm. And see, you're singing my song now because I like Morse code, and I operate it a lot. But for years, many of us have been saying it is an impediment to too many good people in ham radio. And here you are, right in front of us. And once the Morse code requirement was dropped, it made ham radio a possibility for you. So we missed out on many, many years of your experience because of the Morse code requirement. And I don't want to bash Morse code because I like it, but I wish they would have done away with that requirement a long time before they did.
Well, I don't want to bash it either, but in fact, I'm going to attempt to try my hand at it, but I do believe there are certain things that you're better off to learn at an early age and maintain your proficiency as opposed to picking it up much, much later in your life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and at the risk of aggravating a lot of ham radio operators, I can sit here and tell you I prefer you don't learn Morse code, and I'll tell you why. It's not, I enjoy it, and when people enjoy something, they like to share it, and they like it when other people enjoy it, and honestly, I hope you find it as enchanting as I do. But I'm glad you don't have to use your brain power because you have to on Morse code. I would much rather you be developing things for digital communications and other things that are well within your capability than using this brain power on something that many of us think is really pretty useless. But there is no denying the fact that Morse code is a very enchanting form of communication, and that's why I like it, and I hope you will too.
Well, I'm looking forward to trying to see how well I can do at it.
Well, and to some people it comes very easy. Other people struggle with it for many years and never do master it. But you have some experience with it when you were a Boy Scout, so you know what you're in for.
That's right, except one of the things I'm absolutely sure of is I shouldn't get on and start sending the only thing I know, which is SOS.
Yeah, that would be a bad thing to start with. So what form of ham radio are you enjoying now?
Well, it's strictly, I do the HF.
Okay, good.
Making contacts at that. I just recently passed the extra classification. In June the 30th, as a matter of fact, last day of the old set of questions.
Right.
And up here, of course, you have a lot of people that talk on the 2-meter band when they are going to or coming from work.
Right. So you have a band of comfortable old buddies you speak to on your local repeater, and it's always comforting and nice.
It's also good to let you know where the traffic problems are, and you can avoid that and take an alternate route.
right. And now there's other radio services where you can watch out for the police, too, but we'll kind of avoid that. HF, so you're a phone operator on HF, and I'll tell you, I envy you because I'm a terrible phone operator. Phone might be fun if you're loud and if you're not mic shy, two problems of which I have, and I think that's why I like Morse code. I'm just a terrible phone operator. But you do mostly DXing, or do you have a frequency you hang out on with the same people?
I really don't have any special niches. For that, I'm aware that there are guys that like to come on a certain frequency, you know, and chit-chat in the mornings or the afternoons, certain activities like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, what about, now, you know, for about the last 15 years or so, we've heard a lot about, well, I guess since the Pathfinder mission, about various Mars missions. I bet, since you have such a long tradition in history with NASA, that you can tell us some things that we don't know about. What's going on in the discovery of Mars these days?
Yeah, I'd be very glad to give you a little information on that. I have worked with Jet Propulsion Lab, JPL, for almost 15 years on Mars exploration. And, of course, with Mars and the Earth get in close proximity, so the distance is shorter, about every 2 years. So we've had lots of missions that are orbiters or landers. Mm-hmm. And of course, Curiosity is just landed. And I've been working for about 10 years because a lot of these things have an extremely long gestation period where you're doing lots and lots of planning, lots and lots of conceptual designs before anything becomes real. Mm-hmm. So I've been working on Mars sample return, where we're going to actually bring back some robotic samples of Mars, of the soil, of the rock, and the atmosphere.
Okay, now this is something I've not heard of. We've sent numerous craft to Mars, but never brought one back, right?
That's correct.
So this will be a first.
This will be a first, and there's a lot to it because it all has to be done autonomously. There's about a 20-minute time delay in one direction just for the radio transmissions. So when you see something, a picture of Mars, if you saw it in what you thought was real time, mm-hmm. it happened 20 minutes ago.
Right, right. And it's funny you mention that. When the Pathfinder mission was going, I guess sometime shortly after that, we were at opposition with Mars, and the propagation time was in the neighborhood of 15 to 20 minutes. And the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill has a large planetarium, the Moorhead Planetarium, and they had invited the public to come and see the pictures coming back from the Pathfinder. Of course, they were coming back about once every 45 minutes. A picture would be looked at, the Pathfinder would be moved or manipulated, and another picture would be sent back. And it was not disturbing, but it was disappointing to see how many people were disappointed at the slow rate the pictures were coming, because people today just don't understand, you know, propagation delay and path loss. There's almost no appreciation, maybe even among hams, for the tremendous path loss there is from one entire planet to another.
Well, obviously you get signal strength degrades with distance.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to remember that everything we do is all digital, and it comes back as ones and zeros, and then it has to go through an algorithm to be reconstituted back into a picture that you can see.
Mm-hmm.
So that's part of that delay. And the thing with any of the rovers is the way they're operated is you send me a picture, let me look at it,
mm-hmm.
then I will decide which direction I want you to go and how far, and that's generally not very far. And then the command is said, okay, Mr. Rover, move so many meters, then stop and give me another picture.
And that command takes 15 minutes to uplink to the rover.
That's
before
correct.
It can even shoot the picture.
That's correct. Mm-hmm. It takes a picture, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And it sends that information back to the Earth.
Right.
So
20,
that's, let's 15 just say
to 20 minutes.
15 to 20 minutes.
Right.
Okay. Now you've got to think about what you want to tell it to do.
Right.
And that's going to take some time.
Mm-hmm.
Then once you've told it what you want it to do, there's another 15 or 20 minute delay before it says, aha, I hear what you want me to do next.
And then shoot the picture and send that. So a picture an hour would be a good rate.
Possibly, yes.
Yeah. Okay, that's very interesting. When can we look? Now, we know propagation time is 15 to 20 minutes. How long does it take a craft to get to Mars from the Earth?
Well, actually, with our chemical propulsion systems, it takes anywhere from about 10 to 11 months to get to Mars.
Mm-hmm. So, and Mars has to be at a certain point in its orbit. It wouldn't make sense to launch when Mars is at opposition.
Right. Yeah, remember I said earlier that we do it about every 2 years?
Right.
Well, when you consider the orbits of Earth and Mars, about every 2 years, they're actually closer together.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So you're always looking for minimum energy transfers, and that minimizes the size of your launch vehicle and also helps to maximize the payload that you're going to send to the other planet.
Yeah. So you don't shoot at Mars. You shoot at where Mars is going to be, and you do it when that path is going to be the shortest.
That's exactly right. You shoot. You know it's going to take you about 11 months, so you aim for where Mars will be in 11 months, and you move through three gravity sphere influences. You come out of the gravity well of the Earth,
mm-hmm.
then you become under the gravity influence of the Sun,
right.
So you're flying a path like that, and when you get close enough, the Mars's gravity will be the dominant one, and it will pull you in. In that case, you're going to do what's called a Mars flyby unless you slow down. And you can slow down and be captured in orbit, or you can slow down even more, and now you're going to land on the surface of the moon, the Mars, mm-hmm. or crash, whichever.
Now, and if those calculations are wrong, then, of course, the craft would be destroyed. To make a return flight, you can't have damage. So the calculations have to be right.
That's right. You would have to, you would have one asset that would go to the surface, that's your lander, and it would become a launch platform for your Mars ascent vehicle, which would take the material, the rocks and the soil and the atmospheric samples. It would put them, it would be launched, a two-stage mm-hmm. launch vehicle, and it would be launched up to low Mars orbit, where it would have to be acquired by a vehicle already in orbit, and you require the sample container, and then that would go into your Earth return vehicle, which would come back to Earth, and then you would jettison the sample material, and it would come in without a parachute. It would be shaped such it would have a high drag, mm-hmm. and it would basically slow down in the atmosphere, still hit with a fair amount of velocity on the Earth, but your whole package would be designed to accommodate that type of impact G-loading.
Mm-hmm. And heat would be a problem at that kind of reentry.
Oh, that's absolutely right, and you have to use the proper materials of construction to accommodate and tolerate the heat.
Mm. Now, on a return trip, we can easily calculate the position of planets so that the trip to Mars is 9 to 11 months, I think you said, but you wouldn't have that luxury on a return trip unless it could sit on the surface for as many as 20, 22 months, right?
That's also correct. You have a number of options on when you come back, and depending on when you come back, it will take longer for the transit.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
you actually decide what you want to do. And probably what would happen is you'd come up fairly early off the surface of Mars. You would rendezvous your components with the Earth return vehicle, mm-hmm. and it just stays in orbit around Mars until things are right for the return journey.
Mm-hmm. And that could be almost 2 years, right?
It could be, or it could be less. If you were going to do it with people, that's pretty much what, you're absolutely right. You're 10 or 11 months up, and you're going to be about a year, year and a half before everything gets back right, before right. the people would come back.
Right. Oh, yeah, yeah. So there's a lot more to it with people. Now, how big of a payload will this craft bring back? How much rocks and dirt?
Well, right now it's calculated to be 1 kilogram, which is about 0.6 pounds. Did I say that right? 2.2462 kilograms. 2.20462 pounds in 1 kilogram.
You got it. So a couple of pounds is it. That's a long way to go for a couple of pounds of rocks. What can be learned from these rocks?
Well, you can learn an awful lot, because the instruments that you carry to Mars on any craft have to be designed for all the launch and landing, environment loads and all this. So they have to be ruggedized, and they cannot be as sophisticated as lab instruments you would have in a lab back here on Earth. So when you get those samples back, they will be dissected into extremely small number, many numbers of small pieces, and sent out to various labs all over the United States and the world to do all types of investigations on.
Okay, that's pretty good information. So it has to be road-ready equipment to make the trip, to survive the trip, and then the sophisticated measurements will be done here. Will the payload have to be quarantined? I'm thinking back into the about 1970, 71, when I can remember the Apollo missions going and coming from the moon, and the samples went through a quarantine process, because little was known about space travel then. We had left the planet for the first time in the history of mankind. Will these samples have to go through a similar thing, or will they be just available for scientists to use right away?
Well, that's an excellent question, and the answer is yes. Short answer is yes. We will probably convert the lunar receiving lab, which is in Houston, which was used during the moon missions, will probably become the new Mars receiving lab for the samples from Mars. And when you go up, you sterilize your spacecraft as much as possible, because you don't want to say, I found something, and it was something you brought with you. And also, if you do find something, you don't want to release it to the general population, so your container would be hermetically sealed at Mars. It would only be broken up in controlled conditions in a Mars receiving laboratory.
Okay, now that brings up something I never thought of. You know, we think of quarantine to protect us from alien viruses or what have you that we are not familiar with. But it never occurred to me and maybe some of the viewers as well that it needs to be quarantined as well so it doesn't absorb things from people in the lab that would indicate life when none was present.
Well, you certainly don't want to have something that we don't have no immunity to whatsoever.
Right.
And that is a possibility.
Yeah.
So you have to be extremely careful and use controlled conditions to analyze the material.
Okay, let me shift gears. That's interesting stuff. Let me shift gears for a minute and ask you something else. Now, you have a long history with NASA, and you're a ham radio operator. You're familiar with the various awards you can get in ham radio. Worked all this, worked all that. There's plaques, and there's certificates that we call wallpaper and so forth. A couple of years ago, I was at the ARRL headquarters, and I was very surprised to see an award on the bottom shelf of a cabinet there called the Elser Mathis Award. This award was made in 1927. It was announced in the January issue of QST in 1927, it was a colonel, they might have both been colonels in the Air Force, who were friends of the ARRL's founder, Hiram Percy Maxim. This award is to commemorate the first two-way radio contact with Mars. And we know that extraordinary claims have to be supported by extraordinary evidence, so something more than a QSL card is going to be required to claim that award. When I mention that in ham club meetings, if I'm presenting awards and wallpaper and so forth, it's met with a bunch of laughter, scoffing. And it surprises me that hams are, for the most part, short-sighted enough that the reaction seems to be disbelief, you know, that will ever be awarded. What's your feelings on that?
Well, actually, in our solar system, most of the planets, based on what we know from probes we've sent before, is extremely inhospitable to life as we know it. Mars probably has the best chance of any of our planets in our solar system, but yet it is not that hospitable a place either. The average temperature on the surface of Mars is probably, I should know the answer to this, but I can't remember exactly what it is, but Mars is very cold. So the average temperature is probably going to be like, I don't know, 60 degrees below zero Fahrenheit. And also Mars has, as we know it, practically no atmosphere. The atmosphere on the surface of Mars is the equivalent to the atmospheric pressure on Earth at 100,000 feet.
So none.
Well, there is some there, but it wouldn't support you.
Okay, so you would have to take atmosphere, your own environmental housing and so forth, and for an extended period of time, too, because a manned mission would have to last several years just because of the
travel absolutely,
and so
most
forth.
Of the atmosphere of Mars is a very highly concentrated carbon dioxide. It's not oxygen like we have.
Okay, but even so, there's so little of it that even if it was breathable, it wouldn't be enough.
Your mobility suits will not have to be as demanding as a spacesuit we would use in vacuum conditions, but you still got to carry your own oxygen.
Right. Okay, so in our lifetime, probably not a possibility.
Well, actually, Von Braun had a timetable, which I used to have a copy of. It said we had the capability to put people on Mars in 1985. But it cost a lot of money to go to Mars. And one of the things will probably happen is no one country now will do it by themselves. It will have to be a consortium of countries, somewhat like it's been done on the space station. And while we're on the space station, let me put in a plug. most of the astronauts, particularly American astronauts, can't say so much for the cosmonauts, have been ham radio operators. And you can talk to them from orbit using some of the ham radio equipment we have available today.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure which one of these things I'm supposed to look at.
Oh, just me, or this is you too?
I'll look at you.
Interesting. I was lucky enough to make contact with an astronaut named Charles Brady on STS, I think it was STS 76 or 67. It was one of the Columbia missions, Space Shuttle Columbia, and I was very happy to do that. I was on my way back to work from lunch and had timed my lunch hour to coincide with their pass, and it was a 2-meter contact. At that time, they had one downlink frequency and 5 uplinks, but you didn't know which uplink frequency they were listening to, and that's how they would spread the pile up. So 5 of us went to lunch with each of us on one of the uplink frequencies, and just as soon as it came over the horizon, you know, we started calling, and astronaut Brady answered us, and a lot has to fall in place for that to happen. You know, they have to be first at the radio and not have experiments or whatever they're supposed to be doing at that time. So it was a very exciting time around not just the office I worked in, but the radio club at the time too. It was quite a thrill.
Well, since we're here at the Huntsville Ham Fest in Huntsville, Alabama, let me put in a plug for the U.S. Space and Rocket Center here.
Oh, sure.
Which has the largest collection of space hardware in the free world. And I'm a volunteer out there myself because I'm one of the guys that worked on the Apollo program, worked on the Saturn V, worked on the lunar rover, the moon buggy.
Mm-hmm.
And we're out there as unpaid volunteers to give people what I like to call a between-the-lines story. They can read what's written on the plaques, but guys like myself that actually worked on some of that stuff as young engineers, we can tell them some of the war stories that they wouldn't hear otherwise.
So you actually worked on the lunar rover yourself, the design of that.
That's correct.
That's pretty good. Now, a few months ago, I was driving into Alabama from Tennessee on Interstate 65, and right at the state line, imagine my surprise to see a rocket sitting there, and it was a large rocket. I mean, it rivaled the Saturn V.
Well, actually, we used to call that one the baby Saturn. That's the Saturn 1B, and it stands, I think, about 160-some-odd feet tall, and the Saturn V stands 363 feet tall.
So that was half the size of
the Saturn
V.
Yeah, we used to joke that the Saturn V was halfway to the moon before it left the pad.
Okay. I stopped and read everything on every plaque I could find on that Saturn 1B there and was pretty fascinated by it. I've never seen a Saturn V. I was pretty young then and couldn't make the trip to Florida by myself, but I've never...
Well, there's one standing up right out there by the Space and Rocket Center. Now, that is a very high-quality mock-up, but inside the Davidson Center is a real Saturn V flight vehicle. It was a test vehicle. In our terminology, that'd be 500T, like test, mm-hmm. which is actually used to test out, do some structure testing, do some rocket engine testing of various stage elements. But that one could have flown if needed.
Okay, that's good. Well, sure is fun to talk to a rocket scientist. Most of us never get a chance to do that, hardly. And so, what else, if you had a message for young hams today, what would it be?
Oh, gee, that's you're putting me on the spot there. Well, I consider that most anybody that likes ham radio has an interest in things that are somewhat technical, and I would just encourage them to explore it as much as they can and pick out an area that really strikes their fancy. As far as a particular niche, I know when I started coming into this about like 2.5 years ago, it was like drinking from a fire hose. Everybody'd say, well, what do you want to do? And I'd say, well, I don't know. What do you do? You know, and it's an expanding body of knowledge. And but there's something out there for everybody. You just got to see what become more knowledgeable on the subjects and mm-hmm. find something that interests you in particular.
Yeah, and watching videos like this can go a long way towards that. When I first became a ham, it was difficult. I would ask people, you know, well, what can you do with ham radio? And the answer was always, well, you can do anything you want. Okay. Well, I wanted to mow my lawn, rotate my tires, and loan me some cash.
Well, you got to remember something else too. One of the main tenets is to be available in emergencies.
Right.
And we up here in North Alabama saw this last year when we had the tornadoes come in and we were without power for over a week. Well, ham radios were up and operating when everything else was down. Mm-hmm. So the local municipalities became much more appreciative of what we can do and could do. So a good way for people who've never been out to ham radio activities is find out when a field day is going to be held in your locality, and that's generally in June all over, and go out and watch hams in operation. They will let you talk on the, which we call it the GOTA station, get on the air, G-O-T-A, and it's a good way to get exposed to it. Okay. Or come to a meeting of a local chapter.
Yeah, and I agree with you. I think field day is a great thing, and I this year participated with our GOTA station and at our local ham club a lot too. Now you do a lot of volunteer work. You volunteer at the Space Museum, and I know you volunteer in ham radio because I was making you late for your talk-in shift this morning when we first met. Do you work the public service events in the area as well?
Well, a little bit, yes. Well, I've also been in some of the service clubs. I'm a longtime Kiwanis member.
Mm-hmm.
And a friend of mine told me a long time ago, he was a judge, said, you really ought to volunteer your time and your service and your capabilities. He said, it is the social rent you owe for the space you occupy.
Okay, I'm going to wait for a second and let that sink in because that's very valuable. That volunteering is the social rent to pay for the space you occupy. That's very good. And of course, if you know, it's always a challenge to get hams to man the various positions required for these public service events. And so it is our bread and butter. If we can't hang on to our frequencies because we don't do public service, then heaven help the service, the ham radio service. So those are good words. Okay, what else can you tell me?
Well, I think we're about to the end of it. I want to say I've enjoyed talking to you very much.
Okay, David.
And hope some of the listeners will feel inclined to come down and see what we've got here in Huntsville.
Okay, well, I hope so, too. Thanks for joining us, and congratulations, and thank you for joining the ranks of ham radio. We've missed you. Glad you finally made it here.
All right, well, thank you very much.
We're happy to have you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, David. Thank you, Jeff. Now, we got lots more stuff coming up on Ham Radio Now. All that Tapper ARL DCC stuff that we shot, Cliff and I, W4FT and I shot down in Atlanta in September. All of that's coming up. I've got a bunch of other things that are in the hopper waiting to be edited, and we'll be just jamming that through as fast as we can. I would like to invite you to help out. Haven't pushed the money thing in this episode yet, so we'll just talk briefly about being able to make... Come on, Arvin. Come on up here. It's your turn. Make a contribution. If you enjoy the stuff that we do and want to help out, just stop by the website, arvn.tv, and click the pig, click Arvin, and decide whatever you think it's worth to you. Back you go, Arvin. What else? Oh, that's it. It's time to say goodbye. We'll see you next time on Ham Radio Now. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4EQ. Over and out.